Good morning, everybody. Myself is Professor Dr. Rajendra Deshpande. We are in the Ayurved College, Nigdi Pradhikaran, Pune 44. With me are my PG students who are doing the MD in Ayurved. Today is a Saturday, that is 25th of August 2018. Today's lecture will be the third lecture regarding the rheumatoid arthritis, which is compared with the Vata Kapha predominant Vata Rakta in Ayurveda. But this is polyarthritis, is very common. Many patients you will find of rheumatoid arthritis. So there are many lectures regarding rheumatoid arthritis. Today I would like to discuss three important points. I do not know whether all the three points will be covered or not. First point will be differential diagnosis of rheumatoid arthritis. In Ayurveda, it is called as Vyadhi Vyavached Nidana. Vyadhi Vyavached Nidana. Differential diagnosis. Second topic, standard scientific parameters to assess the clinical features of rheumatoid arthritis. There should be some scientific standard parameters, that means quantified parameters. We should be able to assess the clinical features quantitatively and not only qualitatively, because that is something lacking in Ayurvedic students or in some Ayurvedic Vaidyas. Whenever we talk in front of the modern fraternity, we are less in having the capacity to explain on the quantitative basis. And third point, if at all today we get the chance, otherwise in the next lecture, regarding the Maharashtrian tradition for understanding rheumatoid arthritis. Few days back, rather in the last lecture, I had given many formulas or many medicines which are commonly used in South Indian part. But in this lecture or in the next lecture, we will also see some of the important aspects of rheumatoid arthritis considered in the Maharashtra state by many Vaidyas. First point in today's lecture is a differential diagnosis. Patient of rheumatoid arthritis is coming to you with the joint pain or sometimes joint inflammation, swelling in the bony joints. It may be the wrist joint, finger joints, metacarpophalangeal, interphalangeal, elbow, knee, shoulder, any joint. So there are many causes or many diseases where you get the symptom of bony joint pain and swelling. First disease is rheumatic arthritis. Rheumatic is also called as a rheumatic fever. This rheumatic arthritis and rheumatic fever is nowadays mostly outdated because of the strong antibiotics and awareness in the patient. Previously, 10 years back, it was very common in the slum area, in the villages, in the illiterate people. Rheumatic fever or rheumatic arthritis is occurring in the childhood from the age group of 5 to 15 years. Basically, this is a post-streptococcal infection. Post-streptococcal infection. That means the child is brought to you, say for example, 10 years young boy. He had a history of pharyngitis or the sore throat or URTI 10-15 days back. And then all of a sudden, he started the pain at knee joint, pain at the shoulder joint with the high fever. So, rheumatic arthritis is a post-streptococcal arthritis. You can confirm diagnosis by doing the blood test, that is ASO titer. That is a confirmatory test to diagnose rheumatic fever or rheumatic arthritis. ASO titer, anti-streptolysin O titer. it is usually raised in rheumatic fever. Second, this arthritis is a migratory arthritis or the flitting arthritis. That means 2 days the patient will have pain at the elbow joint. After 2 days that child will start that elbow pain has gone. Shoulder pain is started. Again next few days shoulder pain gone. Ankle joint is swollen. So that is called as a flitting or migratory arthritis in the children. That is rheumatic fever. Next important is the big joints are affected. Remember, in the rheumatoid, small joints. In rheumatic fever, big joints. Of course, to begin with. Then both the diseases, it is a polyarthritic type situation. Poly, many joints are affected. Second differential diagnosis, tubercular arthritis. TB, tubercular arthritis, mostly single joint is affected. If the vertebrae are affected because of the TB infection, Mycobacterium tubercle, then it is also called as POTS disease, POTT, POTS disease or cold abscess. Especially if it is occurring in the lumbosacral region and if it is not detected in proper time, patient can lose the power of right or left leg or both the legs. So that is very dangerous. How we can diagnose tubercular arthritis? In addition to the bony joint pain or bony joint swelling, there will be 3 important features of TB. What is that? Number 1, low grade fever, especially evening rise of temperature. Very mild fever, it is not high fever, very mild. Even sometimes patient is not aware of that he is getting the fever in the evening. He just complained, "Doctor, I am always feeling tired in the evening. I had lost my energy. Marathi madhe mala kankan vatte, kankan, feverish." Then the doctor can ask the patient to record temperature at 8 a.m. in the morning, 8 p.m. in the evening. He must buy the thermometer. Doctor can explain how to take the temperature by thermometer, and for the whole week the patient can note morning 8 a.m. temperature, evening 8 a.m. temperature, and definitely he will find that there is a 1 or 2 degree more in the evening. In the morning 98, in the evening 99.5, in the morning 97, in the evening 98.5. So this is not high fever, remember, very mild fever, and that can be unnoticed. So one of the important feature of TB, low grade fever, evening rise of temperature. Second, anorexia, loss of appetite. In TB, patient loses the hunger sensation. And then third, weight loss. These are the important cardinal features of tuberculosis. Maybe pulmonary tuberculosis or maybe extra pulmonary tuberculosis. Remember my words, TB is not affecting only lungs. TB can affect any part of your body. Pulmonary TB, then there will be cough. But if it is extra pulmonary, outside the lungs, then there may not be cough. For example, tubercular arthritis. Abdominal tuberculosis is also very common. Abdominal. Where it is occurring? At ileocecal junction. Abdominal tubercle is observed in ileocecal junction. I hope you have understood tubercular arthritis, only one joint is affected. Plus, three important cardinal features of TB, evening rise of temperature, anorexia and weight loss in last 5-6 months. We are talking about differential diagnosis of arthritis, especially with rheumatoid arthritis. First, we have seen rheumatic arthritis. Second, we have seen tubercular arthritis. Third one, osteoarthritis. Osteoarthritis in Ayurveda, sandhi gatavata. Whenever possible, I will tell you something about Ayurveda also. For example, rheumatic arthritis, we can compare with the amavata because of the migratory fever, migratory joint pain. Amavata, because complication is mitral stenosis. Rheumatic fever, complication, mitral stenosis, rudavikruti. Rudavikruti is mentioned as upadrava of, remember, amavata and not vatarakta. Amavata. Tubercular arthritis, kroshtuka shirsha. Kroshtuka shirsha. The joint, knee joint especially, looking like wolf mouth. Wolf mouth. Kroshtuka shirsha or head. Shirsha means head. Kroshtuka shirsha. It is said, it is not confirmatory, but our great warrior Shivaji Maharaj had also that particular problem of tubercular knee joint arthritis. It is said. I am not confirmed about that. You can confirm by the searching with the history. Third, now I am talking about osteoarthritis, sandhigatavata in Ayurveda. Sandhigatavata. This is old age degenerative osteoarthritis. Because of the old age, after 30, 40, 50 years of age, there is a degeneration in the intervertebral disc, then you get the cervical spondylosis. When there is a degeneration of the lumbar region, intervertebral disc becomes thin. In Ayurveda, it is called as a kapha kshaya and vata prakopa. So you get the lumbar spondylosis or lumbago. But osteoarthritis is commonest in the knee joint and also pelvic joint. Why knee and pelvic? Otherwise every joint is becoming degenerated. Why not your elbow joint? Why not your wrist joint? Why? Because these are weight-bearing joints. Weight-bearing joints. Osteoarthritis is always common in the knee joint. Nowadays, knee joint replacement is very common. According to Ayurveda, this is a vata problem. In the clinical features, in addition to the swelling and pain, important feature is sashabda gamitva in Ayurveda. Sashabda gamitva. Whenever you do the movement of the knee joint, flexion, extension, or walking, sitting, standing, you will find crepitus, C-R-E-P-I-T-U-S. Crepitus is a typical sound created because of the friction of the bony edges. Friction of the bony edges, vata prakop and shleshak kapha kshaya. Shleshak kapha kshaya. Ayurveda compares it as a synovial fluid in your knee joint. That fluid is becoming less. In radiological examination, x-ray of the knee joint, that x-ray is done AP and lateral. You have to advise the patient, do the knee joint x-ray AP and lateral. And what is the important feature? You will find osteophytes. You will find osteophytes. That is the degenerated bony things. So till now, I have completed the differential diagnosis with rheumatic arthritis or rheumatic fever, tuberculous arthritis and osteoarthritis. Number four, traumatic arthritis. Traumatic arthritis, aghataj sandhishul, agantuj sandhishul in Ayurveda. Aghataj, aghat is a trauma. I think this is very easy to diagnose because there is a history of trauma. Usually single joint is affected and with NSAIDs it is relieved immediately within short period of 8 days. Like you can prescribe Chimoral Port, for example. So this is a very temporary phenomena. It is having no recurrence. That is traumatic arthritis, fourth differential diagnosis. Fifth, gouty, G-O-U-T-Y, gouty arthritis or simple gout, G-O-U-T, gout. Again, this can be included in Ayurvedic concept of Vata Rakta. This attack is very acute. It is not slow and steady. All of a sudden in one day, the patient gets a severe inflamed his great toe or thumb, only one finger of the hand or the leg, toe or the thumb, only one to begin with. Severely inflamed, very painful and very tender also. That is called as a gouty attack, G-O-U-T-Y. Usually metacarpophalangeal joint or the great toe is affected. Most important, confirmation by blood uric acid. That is confirmatory. Uric acid levels are always increased in gout. In chronic cases, you may get gouty toffee, T-O-P-H-I. Gouty toffee may present. This is the fifth differential diagnosis. Sixth one, gonorrheal arthritis. Gonorrheal arthritis. This is also mostly temporary phenomena. You will get the history of exposure. That means the patient has visited to the prostitutes, because this is gonorrhea is a sexually transmitted disease, STD. So you can do the VDRL, VDRL blood test, and most important, you have to do the urethral discharge test under microscope. But in gonorrhea, the male patient especially will complain yellowish urethral discharge, history of exposure, history of urethral discharge, and then after a week or some days he will start arthritis. That is called as a complication of gonorrhea. Seventh is a psoriatic arthritis. Psoriasis, this is a skin disease. Psoriatic arthritis, there will be of course the known case of psoriasis. Skin lesions will be seen. Silvery color scales will be there on the body. Terminal interphalangeal joints are involved. Interphalangeal, it's like a rheumatoid arthritis. But of course the other causes and clinical features are different. But interphalangeal joints are affected. Nails, especially you have to observe the nails. Nails are cracked, pitted. That means khadde padlele astat tyanna, and thickened. So in addition to the joints, you have to observe the nails in psoriatic arthritis. Number eight, differential diagnosis, hemophilic arthritis. Hemophilic arthritis. Of course, this is also the known case of hemophilia. known case of hemophilia, and you know the clotting time will be increased. In hemophilia, basically knee joint is affected. There will be blood in the joints. Hemarthrosis may be there, and history of trauma is usually present. Clotting time is raised because there is a defect in the clotting process in hemophilia. This is a bleeding disorder. Ninth is a dysenteric arthritis, very rare, 3% in the population. What is happening? After 3 to 4 weeks, after an attack of acute bacillary dysentery, knee, elbow, wrist, finger joints are commonly swollen. Knee, elbow, wrist and finger joints after the attack of bacillary dysentery. So that is called as a dysenteric arthritis. You may be remembering Ayurvedic reference, ya eva purish dhara kala sa eva asti dhara kala. So Ayurveda believes that there is a relation in between your stools or the waste product and the quality and quantity of the waste product and relation of the bones quality. So there is a passing remark that ya eva asti dhara kala sa eva purish dhara kala. 10th differential diagnosis is Reiter's syndrome, R-E-I-T-E-R, Reiter's syndrome. Here mainly male gender is affected. This is a 2 or 3 clinical features, symptoms are together, that's why it is called a syndrome. One is polyarthritis plus non-gonococcal urethritis. Non-gonococcal urethritis. Patient will complain burning micturition. Plus polyarthritis. Plus conjunctivitis. 3 different symptoms of different system. But they are seen together, and that is invented by Reiter scientist. So that is called as a Reiter's syndrome. What he has observed? Polyarthritis plus urethritis plus conjunctivitis, then he give the name Reiter's syndrome. Is it okay? Then joints of the lower limbs are affected, basically ankle, knee and pelvic joints are affected in Reiter's syndrome, very rare. And 11th is a pyogenic arthritis. This is monoarticular, single joint is affected, skin is red, edematous, glossy and tender, local temperature is raised, and most important is constitutional symptoms are present because pus is in the your knee, joints, so you will get a high fever, patient will be toxic. Pyogenic arthritis, because pus is there, so high fever in the body, that is called as a constitutional symptom. High fever, headache, and patient will look toxic. Gambhir disun yel tumhala. That is pyogenic arthritis, but of course very rare, because now there are lot of antibiotics. This pyogenic arthritis, tubercular arthritis, rheumatic fever, they are olden types of the arthritis. But they may be seen once in a while. So I hope, my dear friends, that you have understood that there are, but of course I have already given you the classification. In the practice, 45% cases patients, if you consider the total of your practice of 1 year, for example, and if you seen 100 patients of arthritis, what will be the classification? 45 will be of rheumatoid, 45 will be of osteoarthritis, and only in 10% remaining these 8 topics will be there. Okay, so this is in general classification. Next, second topic we will cover, a little bit small topic, that is the scientific parameters to assess, scientific parameters to assess, to examine the clinical features of rheumatoid arthritis, but these parameters can be used for any arthritis. You can use these parameters. I have used these parameters when I had done my MD in Kaya Chikitsa 30 years back and having the Amrutaji Gugul clinical trials in rheumatoid arthritis. This criteria is also called as a severity index. Severity index. What is the purpose? You are more and more doing the quantity analysis. Because Ayurveda always talks in general. For example, in Marathi, many Vaidyas say like this, Majakade to patient ala and he had a lot of serious problem and then afterwards he was cured and he was very fine. So very problematic and very fine, this doesn't have any quantification. And that's why chala khup suj hoti and ti sagai suj naishi zali. Even you see the case papers in the Ayurvedic hospitals, I am sorry to say, but some of the hospitals, I am not saying all, but many hospitals, they have the vague mentioning, for example, Vedana. So they write 1 plus, 2 plus, 3 plus. If they ask, what is 1 plus, they don't answer. For example, another is a Vikrut and Prakrut. The Kriya, for example, Sandhi Kriya, Vikrut. What is meant by Vikrut? Don't, can't answer. Then after few days, it was Prakrut. But what is Prakrut? They can't answer. So it is better to have the quantification. So we will see one by one. Number one, regarding the deformity. Regarding the deformity in arthritis. So we will write like 0, 1, 2. 0, this is the numbering. 0 is equal to absent. So whenever deformity is not there, contracture or any atrophy, no deformity, then 0 grade. 1 is a temporary deformity. Temporary deformity, what does that mean? For example, if I have a huge swelling at the elbow joint and I cannot extend my elbow joint, this is also deformity, but that is a temporary deformity. So that is 1. But after chronic city of the rheumatoid arthritis, repeated inflammation, sometimes there becomes the fibrosis. And whenever fibrosis is always permanent. So I had one patient like this. She had a rheumatoid arthritis of the cervical region and she has a permanent flexion of the neck on the right side. That is called as a permanent deformity. So 0, absent, 1, temporary deformity, and 2, permanent deformity. This is called as a gradation, and gradation is very important in your practice. Now on the second line, one line blank, you write down swelling. Swelling, again 0, 1, 2, 3. 0, always absent. 0 means no swelling. 0 is absent. 1, mild swelling. 2, moderate swelling. And 3, severe swelling. Mild, moderate and severe. These words should be used when you write down the case paper of arthritis. Don't write swelling present and absent. No. Mild, moderate, severe. Tell us. Severe was converted to the moderate. Moderate is converted to the mild. Mild is converted to the absent swelling. So this should be the gradation. Third clinical feature is redness. Whenever there is inflammation, that joint looks red, hot. 0, absent redness. 0 is absent. 1, slight redness. And 2, markedly redness. Very, very, looking very shiny red. Fourth feature, muscular wasting. Fourth, in arthritic patient, muscular wasting, common in the rheumatoid and osteoarthritis. Muscle becomes atrophied. 0, absent, no wasting. 1, slight wasting is there. And 2, marked wasting is there. Of course, you know, wasting is coming under the topic. Which topic? Nutrition of the muscle. Remember, nutrition of the muscle, you have to take the measuring tape. Measuring tape, and then compare right and left sided of the muscles. So that is muscular wasting. Fifth clinical feature, local temperature. By your dorsum of the hand, you have to test by touching the joint, local temperature. Zero. Local temperature not raised. Zero is not, no raising, normal temperature. One, slightly raised local temperature. Slightly raised. And number two, markedly raised local temperature. Very hot. Markedly raised. Sixth clinical feature is tenderness. Tenderness. In Ayurveda, it is called as a sparsha sahatva. Patient is not agree to touch that particular part. Tenderness. Zero. No tenderness. One. Patient complains of tenderness. One, patient complains of tenderness. When you touch the part, patient will say, doctor, thoda dukte mala. That is only complaint. Dukte thoda mala. Number two, complain and winced. W-I-N-C-E-D. That means he will moan. To oldel. Ah, doctor, pain is there. In the first, he was just telling that, doctor, mala thoda dukte. When you touch in the second, he will moan. Oh, it's severe pain. Third, complain and withdrew. Withdrew. That means he will take away that part. He will grumble and also he will take away the part. So 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. This should be the, this is very important. The tenderness is very important for arthritis. So write down IMP feature, tenderness. Seventh is a movement. Movement. Zero. Not restricted. No restriction of movement. One. One is equal to slightly restricted. And two. Markedly restricted. Markedly restricted. What is meant by slightly restricted? For example, I have the lumbar pain. So, while sitting and I am sitting. So, I can, by grumble, I can sit down or I can stand up. But, when I say markedly restricted, for the 5 minutes, I will not be able to sit. No, you say, you go, I will sit afterwards. So, that is called as a markedly restricted because it takes a long time to get into that action. Maybe sitting, maybe walking, maybe standing, okay? So, slightly restricted, markedly restricted. Eight, grip strength, grip, especially for the fingers. How is your grip? G-R-I-P. So, it can be tested by asking the patient to blow or to pump the bulb of sphygmomanometer. You have to use mercury sphygmomanometer and ask the patient to rise the mercury column by pressing the pump. Remember, you have to use the instrument for understanding the strength in the fingers. Do you understand how, what to do? He has to ask the pump, 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 and that mercury will be raised in the mercury column in the BP apparatus. So BP apparatus should be used for grip strength. Zero. Normal strength. He can easily raise greater than 280 mm of Hg. Mercury will raise, you know the last number, do you remember? Last number on the BP apparatus, 300. 300 is the last number, top. So the patient can raise above 280. That is normal. Now one, moderate strength. Moderate strength. Into bracket, how much he can raise? From 140 to 280, he can raise the mercury column in the BP apparatus by pressuring the pump from 140 to 280 mm of Hg, millimeter of mercury. That is one. Second, submoderate. Submoderate means below moderate. And range is, the patient can raise the mercury column only from 40 to 140 mm of Hg. You have to use the BP apparatus, remember, grip strength. And third, poor strength, poor, no power because of the arthritis. That is less than 40. Patient cannot raise the mercury column above 40 mm of Hg. That is very poor. Next feature, ninth, is very, very, very IMP. You write down in this way. Pain grade, pain. Pain is the main thing in the arthritis. In the, maybe osteoarthritis, it may be the rheumatic fever, it may be rheumatoarthritis, tubercular, every arthritis there will be pain. How you can grade the pain? It is also a topic of your research. Nowadays what they are talking about regarding the pain? In the your thesis, dissertation, they are expecting to measure the pain. How, what type they are using? That is called as a VAS. V-A-S. This is a research word, VAS. Remember what is VAS? VAS is a visual analog scale. Visual analog scale. V-A-S. VAS. VAS for pain. VAS for pain. You know what is that? You have to draw a line on the paper and you have to give the numbers 0 to 10. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. 10 centimeter line. When the patient first time comes to you, ask him, how is your pain? He will put the finger on the 10. Very severe. I am getting very severe pain. Next time he will come, he will put the finger on the 70. That is, my pain has reduced to 70. After 1 month, he will say it is only 20. Actually, VAS is the latest term used by the research scholars. But many, many practitioners were very from the beginning, say 100 years, they are using the same things in their practice. Do you know how they are using? What was their language? I had also used this term. आमी patient ला मराठीत विचारायचो, तुला रुपयाला किती फरक पडला? Do you know this language? किती आणे फरक पडला? पूर्वी आणे असायचं 25 पैशाचे, 1 coin of 25 पैसे. You have now 1 rupee coin. We used to ask this question. किती बाबा तुला फरक पडला? पूर्वी समजा तुझं 100% असेल तर आता किती बरं वाटतंय? तोंडो निम्म्यानी कमी झालंय. What is meant by nimyani kami zale? It is 50%. It is your same VAS terminology. So VAS is only the term that is newly coming up with the research. But otherwise, this was used to be done by the research scholars. So this pain gradation is very, very important in the practice. It is not only for arthritis, but I will say any damp pain in your body. It may be the headache, it may be the body ache, it may be the neurological pain. Ruja nasti vata drute. You know this term? Ayurvedic term is there. Ruja nasti vata drute. Otherwise, vata drute nasti ruja. What I have learned? Vata drute nasti ruja. Pain cannot occur without the involvement of vata pathology, as Ayurveda says. Whenever there is a pain, whenever, it may be the muscular pain, it may be the bony pain, it may be the bony joint pain, it may be the neurological pain, any pain cannot occur without the involvement of pathology of vata dosha. Remember this thing. So, pain is very important in our practice. And that's why I'm giving you important four grades. How you can say that what pain has been controlled. Zero is equal to no pain. When there is no pain, you write down zero pain. One, number one, is equal to intermittent pain. Intermittent, not continuous. Yes, 2 days back I had headache. Now there is no headache. In the morning I had little bit pain in my knee joint, but today it is better. Right now it is better. So intermittent, not continuous. Second, restriction of movement due to pain. That is more severe. Restriction of movement due to the pain. Third, unable to do the normal movement. There is a difference. Restriction of movement is different and unable to do normal movement. For example, my fingers are so much swollen that I cannot hold the cup in my hand. I cannot eat by myself. I cannot wash my toilet. That is called, I cannot stand up from the sitting position. So such a pain in the pelvic joint, such a pain in the knee joint that I cannot walk a single step. That is called as unable to do the normal movement. That is very severe, third grade. And fourth, unable to do the normal movement plus unable to sleep due to the pain. His sleep is disturbed. Then that is definitely 100% very, very severe type of the pain. That is called as emergency. The doctor must give something to manage that pain. So the treatment part is more and more aggressive when you go for zero pain to the fourth grade pain. So again I repeat, zero, no pain. One is intermittent pain. Two is a restriction of movement due to the pain. Third is unable to do normal movement. Do you understand the difference in restricted movement and normal movement? When I have to run, walk for a longer distance and I cannot, that is restriction of movement. But I cannot walk for two steps. That is the unable to do normal movement. That much I should do, able to do. Do you understand? I cannot get up from my... Okay, I cannot jump. That is called as a restriction of movement. But I should be able to at least stand from the sitting position. That is the normal movement. Do you understand the difference? Then, when your sleep is disturbed, that is very serious pain. When I remember one thing very important regarding the headache, remember, we are always concerned with the migraine. There are a lot of people in your practice regarding the either stress headache or the migraine type of the headache. But when the patient tells you that my pain is continuous, it is disturbing, I cannot concentrate, I cannot learn, and even last 8 days in the morning I wake up because there is a pain, headache is there. Remember, you must immediately do the MRI. Immediately do the MRI in this headache of the night, because that can be tumor. Remember my words. Don't forget it. If any patient complains you, he is getting the pain since last many months, but other things are okay. He cannot tolerate the sun. He cannot concentrate his office work, homework, classwork. It is everything. But when he started to complain you that my pain is going on increasing, is disturbing my whole thing, but at night now I am waking up. I have to wake up at 2 o'clock in the morning and I can't sleep because of my headache. Immediately refer to the MRI of the head and you will find some tumor in the brain. That is very serious thing regarding the pain. Tenth feature of the arthritis is the morning stiffness. Of course, this is very specific in only rheumatoid arthritis. Morning stiffness is very common in two occasions. One I found in rheumatoid arthritis and second is also the lumbago. In lumbago also, this morning backache is very common. After resting condition, you get up and you get the backache. That is a calcium deficiency. That is called as a lumbago. So morning stiffness, you have to grade it. Zero, no morning stiffness. One grade is equal to stiffness less than 30 minutes. Only 30 minutes you get the problem. Afterwards, it is okay. You are little bit more comfortable with your joints. 2, 30 minutes to 2 hours, stiffness remain up to 2 hours, that is grade 2 is severe, and third grade very severe when stiffness remains more than 2 hours. He get up at the 7 o'clock or 6 o'clock and till 12 o'clock, till breakfast, till lunch, he is not relieved from the stiffness, that is very serious. This is also an important feature, you write down. So, when you start Ayurvedic treatment, remember my words, you have to concentrate on pain and morning stiffness. Then you can say, my patient is improving. In addition to doing the ESR, that is also objective parameter, this is clinical parameters that you must assess. And last part of the lecture, it is called as the functional classification, functional class, CLASS, class of ARA scale, ARA, anti-rheumatic association or anti-rheumatoid association scale. So class 1, complete ability to carry on all usual duties without handicap. I will repeat, class 1 is very mild, that is normal person. Complete ability to carry all usual duties without handicap. Svatata svatata sagal karta yeta paravalambitva nahi. That is a normal phenomenon, that is called as a remission phase. Do you understand? Avegavastha. Then grade 2. Adequate activities, despite handicap or discomfort or limited motion at one or more joints. Class 2 is adequate activities despite handicap. For example, although I have the wrist pain, I have the finger pain, I have the shoulder pain, but still I can wash, I can do brushing, I can take my own food, I can write slowly, but I can do that. I can wash my toilet, I can get up from the chair, I can move little bit, that is called as a, there is a pain, there is a problem, but still little bit more, better. Class 3. Now, the patient is becoming handicapped. Little or no duties of usual occupation or self-care. Brushing, washing the toilet, taking the food, little bit walking, the patient cannot do. That is little bit serious, class 3. And class 4, can you judge what will be the class 4? Last severe, what is the severe illness? How you can say the patient is very serious? How you can say of rheumatoid arthritis? Yes, that's right. Bedridden. The patient cannot get up from his bed and everything is depend on the another wife or the children or the husband. So you are totally paravalambitva, handicapped. You cannot perform any duties of your own. No eating of your own. You have to take the bed pan. You have to give the urine pot. Okay. Everything is on the bed. Because that much arthritis is severe. So, whenever this is called a total classification. So, first is a normal person in the stage of remission. Then class 2, pain is there but patient is doing something. Third, a little bit more problem. And last is a totally bedridden. So, my dear friends, today, that is 25th of August 2018 on Saturday, Professor Dr. Deshpande gave the two important topics. One is a differential diagnosis of arthritis and second was gradation of the clinical features of the rheumatoid arthritis. So, thank you very much for your patience hearing. I wish you all the best. Take care. And please subscribe my YouTube channel. Thank you.